I guess you know what that's about. So the midterm scores are up on the webpage if you want to look at them. Put in your last name, which may not be what you think your last name is, but it's what the registrar thinks your last name is. So for some people who have two names in their last name, sometimes it comes out weird. You put in your last name and your ID number, and you can see what grade you got and what letter equivalent it is. People did worse on the exam than I expected. I thought it was a relatively easy exam, but clearly you don't agree. If you got below an 80, which means you got an F, a D, or a C minus, that doesn't mean you're going to fail this class. So one thing that confuses people at first is a C minus is not a grade that you want, because it means that while this course counts towards graduation credit, it doesn't allow you to take the next course in the sequence. If you need this for your major, it also doesn't count. I mean, it counts, but it doesn't fulfill the requirement. So if you're an engineer and you need to take this class, you need to get a C or better. If you were a math major, you need to get a C or better to take multivariable calculus. So whatever program you're in, if you're taking this course because it's required, you need to get a C or better. If you've got a C minus on this exam or even a D, it doesn't mean your life is over, you're failing, goodbye, just die. What it means is either you have to change what you're doing. So the next exam will actually be harder than this one. Sorry, it just is harder material. So the next exam will be harder. I just said that. If you got below an 80 on this exam, you can recover from that by not necessarily working harder, but working more intelligently. So I know that some people, for example, when they do their homework, they do it all together in a group. And what answer did you get? Oh, I got that answer too. Okay, that's the answer. That is a way to figure out stuff, but that isn't necessarily a way to make sure that you know it rather than your friend knows it. There's also the possibility of moving down from Math 132 to Math 126, or even Math 131, or I mean even Math 103 if you want. But that needs to be done by a week from Friday. There's a form on the class webpage, also on the registrar's website, which you fill out. If you're a freshman, you get your advisor to sign it, and you also get either someone in the math department or the professor in the new course to sign it. You take it to the registrar's office, and then abracadabra, you've been in that course since the beginning of the semester. So there's no W on your transcript. You should not withdraw from this class. If you're one of the two people who got a zero on the exam, then you should not withdraw from this class. What you should do is get that form, figure out what math class you belong in, take that form to the math department, and get it signed, take it to the registrar, and then be in that other class. If you move to Math 126, Math 131, or Math 125, it's the same textbook. So you just flip back some amount of space in your exam. I'm not telling you get out of this class. I'm just telling you that's an option. One thing you should be aware of, if you always got A's in high school and you didn't get an A on this test, that doesn't mean you should get out of this class. Usually in most of the math classes, only about at most 20% of the students get an A or an A minus. So, and on this exam, the number of A's was about, including A minuses, was about 17%. It's just the way it is. A's are hard to get. A's mean something. Or at least they mean something here. There are other places where the average grade is an A. That's not true at Stonefield. So, an Getting an A is a significant achievement in these classes. A B, well, B's are, I mean, I gave a lot of B's and I gave a lot of C's. Also, unfortunately, gave a lot of B's because it's a lot of people that only did like one or two questions, right? Okay, any questions about the exam? So you'll get the exam back at your recitation either today, tomorrow, or Wednesday, depending on when you have recitation. Any questions? No? Okay, so everybody knows how to check their exam. You probably have already done it, right? No? Okay, so if you go to the class rotation, you can check this. All right. Other questions? No? All right, so we need to move along then. So, what we've been doing and what we will continue doing for the next class or two is this idea about, so, you know, the sort of the core idea of this section of the class is that an integral, geez, having troubles here. Well, an integral is the same as adding up lots of little things. So we saw already that an integral of a function is the area under the curve. You see that? You add up lots of skinny lines and fill them in area. We see that an integral of a cross section, so if you integrate from area, the whatever, if this is a volume, and we're adding up lots of, let's make a rotation. So I have some object, and I add up the area of lots of slices, and I get a volume. Another thing that we did, we saw that the average value is just the area over the width. So we take something like that and we average by the width, that gives us the average value. And the last thing that we saw last time was that arc length, I didn't leave enough room. So the length of the curve is, if we have a curve and we approximate it by little short segments, you can't see that. It's like 900 degrees in here. So if I just pass out of here, then you can leave. Okay. So the length of a curve, let me just put that away. So the length of a curve, which we also did last time, is that I add up the length of a bunch of lines. And you want to find the length of these short lines. And so what we did last time, if this is dx, and this is dy, and this is the square root of dx squared plus dy squared, which is the same thing as 1 plus the derivative. So if we divide through by dx back to the dx out, right? So we did this last time. Does anyone need to see another example of arc length? You do. Okay. So the problem with arc length is almost always the integrals that you get are horrible, and you have to do them numerically. Because there are very few functions for whom 1 plus the derivative squared take the square root is something you can integrate. So I'm just going to write down an integral. I'm not going to do the integral because it would be ugly. But of course I hadn't planned one. They're all the same. Let's just say, so just to remind you of this example. So what is limit of y equals 1 over x from, so as you can see, this would be a good clicker question, but the computer's still working, so just pretend it's a clicker question. From x equals 1 to x equals 4. Okay, so this is the kind of question you should be able to do. What I'd like you all to do is to do it. And then we'll hold up your clicker and we'll see what you can do. So, does anyone here not know how to do this question? So if I call on one of you at random, you can just tell me the right answer, right? That's me. So I don't need you to do the integral, I just want you to write an integral. Now this is something that should be trivial, but the formula is right there. So this is like really a stupid question. But given what I saw on the exam, even if the formula is right there, there are lots of people that can't do the problem. Okay, so somebody want to tell me what this integral is? Nobody wants to tell me what? Okay, I'll start it. Here, I'll put another part in for you. Here we go. Here, I'll put in the next part. Okay, somebody tells me what's next, please. So let's move on. So I can ask the computer to do that and get a number without too much trouble. But it's just a x squared is the tangent. Maybe, I don't know, maybe you can do this by trig substitution, like x squared is the tangent. But I don't want to. Okay, so let's move on to the next topic. So we have a bunch of these little ideas that if we slice the thing up into different ways, then we get something we want. So one application of this that comes up in, for example, physics is this idea of work. So one thing that one does in physics is you deal with forces. So for example, force equals mass times acceleration. And the amount of work involved in exerting a force is how much you need to exert that force for. So for example, the work to exert a force over a certain distance is the amount of force that you need to exert times the distance that you need to exert it. So, for example, how much does this book weigh? I don't know how much it weighs. Let's call it 5 pounds. So the rate, the work involved in lifting this book, let's say it weighs 3 pounds. The work involved in lifting this book 1 foot. So the work to lift a 3 pound book 1 foot is not 3 foot-pounds because there's the force of gravity involved. So the force of gravity is feet per second. I went in feet. 32. Is 3 times the force of gravity. That's the force. Let's call it 2 feet. So that doesn't seem right. Okay, well, whatever. Is 6g foot-pounds. I guess that's the whatever 32 times 6 is, 180, 196 foot-pounds. So there's this confusion about whether we're talking about forces, whether we're talking about weight or mass. So this 3 pound book, this is the mass, and the force involved is 3g. But if we're talking about a force, then we just add up the force. Okay, doesn't matter. Both doesn't matter. So maybe I did that right. You can do this in meters and newtons and joules and all of that junk if you prefer. I don't care. This is not physics class. Depends on how the question is phrased. So that's fine. That just says we exert a force, a constant force over a given distance, and over the force of 2 feet, the force of gravity does not vary very much, so we can call it constant. But if the force is not constant, then we have to do what? So if we don't know if the force moves a little, if the force changes, right? So at this point, it's harder to do than it is here. How can we solve this? So for example, let me give you an example of this. So we're stretching a string. So if we're stretching a spring, then Hooke's law says that the force is proportional to the distance stretched Beyond the natural limit. In other words, the force is some constant times x. So let's call it minus x max. So if I have a spring, which I don't have one here. Anybody have a spring? Okay, so if I have a spring, so imagine a spring here, and I just pick it up and it's this long, and I stretch it out like that, then I need to know that to hold it here takes no force. To hold it stretched out here takes some amount of effort to hold it stretched at that length. And the amount of effort I need is proportional to how far I stretch it beyond the place where it just wants to hang out. Right? So, I don't know if you can even think in this heat.
I can.
So, I have a spring here, which has some typical natural length. And the force to stretch it out here is proportional to how far it's gone. So to stretch it from, say my spring is, should I do it in meters now? No, well, if I do it in meters, I can't stretch it very far. So it has a natural length of 1/2 meter. And now if I want to stretch it, and let's just say it has some constant, so I'll just give you a spring constant. Out of the next one. 2. So I won't even tell you what that means. So then how would we figure out how much work because to stretch it from 1/2 meter from 0.5 meters to 0.6 meters is a whole lot easier than to stretch it from 0.9 meters to 1 meter. It's a whole lot harder, pulling a lot harder when I'm out here near 1 meter than it is when I'm out here near 1 meter. Then that's 2 meters. When I'm out here near 1 meter than it is when I'm in here. Right?
That's 1/2 meter.
I can't tell if you're following this. Or you're just dying of heat? Yeah, both of those. Well, both is okay. Is this clear? So how would we figure it out? What would we do? Okay, I'm going to integrate the force. So I want to integrate the force here, dx. And in this case, the force is 2 times the distance it's been stretched past 1/2. So in this case, so it's going to be 2 times x, where x goes, from 0 to 1/2. Alright, so I can write this in 2 ways. I can either write this as x going from 0 to 1/2 to 2x dx, or if you prefer, from 1/2 to 1 of 2u minus 1/2. These are the same. The reason I wrote this in these two different ways. Try and make the formula in the same. So here, if this is my spring,
I could either let X be this distance, or I could use this distance. Right? Either way. Whichever way seems to make more sense to you is fine. So, because I wrote the formula 2 times X minus 1/2. Right? So, force is either 2 times the distance I stretched it minus the distance I stretched to 2 minus its natural length, which is the same thing where X is the distance it stretched beyond its natural length. So these are not hard. Is it clear to everyone why this is an integral? Is it clear to anyone why this is an integral? Because it's calculus class, so of course we're integral. Somebody want to tell me why this is an integral? Okay, so why, if it's not a constant force, should I integrate? Well, yeah, but I have to think anyway, I'm not here. So, I mean, why possibly would I integrate? If it's a constant force, could I integrate it? Would it make sense if the force is constant to use an integral? I see a lot of no's. Why not? So, it works perfectly well if I use an integral when it's a constant force. If I have a constant force of 18, and I want to apply that force over a distance of 2 meters, then I can integrate from 0 to 2 of 18 dx. This is 18x, evaluated from 0 to 2 is 36. It's exactly the same thing. So it makes perfect sense to integrate if it's constant, it's just stupid. It's like it makes perfect sense to drive your car to your mailbox in a 10-meter driveway, except it's just stupid. By the time you start up the car and roll down to the end of the driveway, you could have gone up and down 14 times. But you can do it, and it's exactly the same mechanism. So the idea here, the reason we're integrating, is over a tiny little interval of time, or a tiny little interval of distance, the force is approximately constant. So this integral here, or here, when we integrate force dx, this means add up the work over tiny increments. So this fdx here represents the amount of work I need to do to move my object dx units. So this dx is not just a stupid thing that we use this on writing. It actually represents the distance, the infinitesimal distance, that I'm applying this force over. So this means I add up the amount of work that I do to stretch my spring from here to here, and then the amount of work I do to stretch my spring from here to here, and then from here to here, and then from here to here, and here to here, and eventually I actually get some distance. All right. So we can do other examples of this kind of thing, like the amount of work required to, say, pump some water out of a tank, or any of those kinds of things. Maybe I should do an example like that. Or not. Or should I do another spring example where we figure out the constant, or then go ahead? It seemed to me in the context of figuring out the constant on the exam was a lot of trouble for a lot of people. So let me do a slightly different example in the vein of this before I do, say, water pumped out of the tank or something. So say that it takes... So say I have a spring and it takes some number, 40 newtons of force to hold the spring. Tell you what the constant is. So how do I figure out what the constant is? What is the constant? So let's maybe change it to 2 meters. 20. Okay, that's pretty hard. So here, the constant, since it takes 40 newtons to hold it 2 meters beyond its natural length, that means that the constant is, so, the force is a constant times the distance beyond its natural length, and the force here is 40, so the constant is 1. Okay, that's pretty easy. Now that I have the constant, this problem becomes the same as the last problem. That is, force involved, the work involved, I have to apply it from 1 to 3 to the constant of 20. So I just integrate 1 to 3 the force dx. No? So read the question. The question says if I hold it at 2 meters, it takes me 40 newtons of force. It says 2 meters beyond its natural length. Now my question is still, I want to stretch it from 1 meter to 3 meters. How much work? So that's the integral, 1 to 3, of 20, which is 10x squared from 1 to 3. Which is 90 minus 10 is 80, I guess it's joules. Right? It's, unless I integrate it wrong, which is quite possible. Yeah?
Aren't you supposed to integrate force instead of the constant?
The force is 20. The force...
Isn't the force 40?
Is 20... x, where x is the distance stretched beyond its natural length. So I did integrate the force. The constant is force, the force is constant times x.
If your force is more complicated, then you have a more complicated integral. But usually in these problems, the force is not so complicated. Okay, so I guess let's do one more example of this. But again, the idea here is that work is just the integral of force over the place of time. So say I want to, let's make it easy, let's make it a cylindrical tank. Say I have a cylindrical tank filled with water, and I want to pump. Water. Maybe let's make it a little harder and make it conical. All right, we'll do cylindrical first. So let's say that the tank has a radius of 10 meters and a height. The water here has a height of, looks like 20 meters. So the cylindrical tank is filled with water. Oh, and the total height is 30 meters. So I want to pump this tank empty. And I want to figure out how much work is involved. Notice that it's more work to pump it from the bottom than to pump it this way, right? I have a little straw, and it goes out. Well, it doesn't go over the hook. I have a cap up here. I'm going to pump it out the top. So how do I figure out how much work this is? I have to figure out the forces involved. Or the amount of work to pump it out at a little close. So what do I do? Again, the point here is not to memorize formula. The point here is to attack problems and figure out how to solve it. So what is it that I need to do to calculate how much, oh, I guess I should say how much the water weighs. So the mass, let's say the mass of water. Well, the mass of water is 1 kilogram per square meter, right? Is that right? Yeah. So that makes it easier. Cubic meter, sorry. So water, it's not honey. So and my everything is in meters. So we can just forget about everything's in the right units. We don't have to think about units. Units will just work. So what do I do? I'm sorry, is someone telling me what to do? Okay, what do I do? Say it again, I didn't do it. Calculate the volume, okay? The volume of water or the volume of... So you're saying if I slice it here, you're saying that volume? Yes? Yes? Okay, so the volume at height, let's call it H, of a wind pH is pi times 100. Pi r squared pH, right? If I take a little slab of water, which is dH tall, and since it's cylindrical, it's 10 meters across, then the volume at that height, that little slab of water is dH. I mean, is 100 pi dH, okay? So the mass, okay, good, now it's right. The density, multiply by the height. So why do I multiply by the height? But I'm not draining the tank, I'm pumping it out of the top. Nope. So what's wrong with that? So this is almost right. So what's wrong with this approach? Your H goes the wrong way. So if I'm draining the tank, your answer is perfectly right because it's going this way. So there's a lot of energy here and very little energy here. But I'm not draining the tank. I'm picking it up from the bottom and taking it out the top. So this stuff is a lot of work to get out, and this stuff is not much work to get out, and there's a space. So what I have to do is let H, I could, one thing I could do is let, instead of H, I could call it, well, D's a bad, I mean, if I call it D, then it's ED. So what's another word for depth? I'll just call it H. So H is the distance this way. If I let H go that way, then I'm fine. It's the height I have to lift the water. Yeah, so if you want H minus H naught. Yeah?
Shouldn't it be going to pi over H? That would be there.
No. The 100, so, okay. So the volume of a slice is pi R squared times the, well, H is times the height, right? That's the volume of the little cylindrical slab. In this case, H is dH, because it's a skinny little slab. R is 10, so R squared is that. So the volume is 100 pi dH. The mass of the slice is easy because it's 1 kilogram per cubic meter, so it equals the volume. So this is 100 pi times dH kilograms. And now this little discussion that we had is, now the work involved, the mass times the distance I have to move it. So the work is the mass times the distance, which is, in this case, the mass is there, is 100 pi times how thick it is, times this distance here. I have to get it from here to there. So if this distance is h, then it's 30 minus h. And so this distance, let's not use upside down. So if this slab is at height h, then this is 30 minus h that it has to go. And so now the work is a pretty straightforward integral. It's the integral. The water goes up to a depth of 30 meters. And so I want to figure out the work that it is. Get the water from the bottom all the way up to the 20 meter line. So it's 100 pi. I'm going to integrate 30 minus h. H, that's the force needed. That's what I need to get from here to there. And I just integrate that from 0 to 20. Okay? So, I mean, we can make these problems a little harder. We can make the tank be conical or spherical or whatever. But the idea is the same. We slice it up and see how much work it takes to get out. The idea of pressure is the same. And all of these ideas are the same idea. In fact, this whole thing is kind of the same idea. If you want to figure out a big thing, figure out what happens infinitesimally in any rate. So it's too hot here to move on, so I'm going to stop. So I want to remind you there's still web design, even though we have an exam next week. There's still paper homework. All that horrible stuff there is gone. Do we have another exam next week? That's the exam last week. So, you don't get a vacation. Well, the exam is the
Hey, John.